30
plus years of service, combat medals, citations, only man to shoot down 3 enemy planes in the last 40 years, distinguished, 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 yet you can't get a promotion, you won't retire, and despite your best efforts, you refuse to die. You should be at least a 2-star admiral by now, if not a senator. Here you are. Why is that? It's one of life's mysteries, sir. Welcome to Should You Watch This with the Popcorn Priest, the weekly podcast where movie enthusiasts, current and ex-movie theater projectionists, new and old friends, take the time to talk about a movie that we just watched and answer that very question, should or shouldn't you watch this? Did Tom Cruise save movies? Did this deserve all the hype and money spent and made? Find out as we strap in and get oiled up yet again 36 years later for Top Gun : Maverick from 2022.
My dad believed in you. I'm not gonna make the same mistake.
You know what happens to you if you go through with this.
I have everything I need to have you court-martialed and dishonorably discharged.
The end is inevitable, Maverick.
What are you gonna do?
Here they come! Over the air! Over the air! Everyone!
Joining me today is Dan Sacklunch Sekulich. What's up, man? Welcome back to the show.
Dude, thank you. My heart's already pounding.
Dude, that was a great trailer, right?
It was amazing.
I mean, this was your pick. And to be honest, I'm really glad that you did.
You know, I don't get many movies except for when you invite me on the pod.
Sure.
And this was an anticipated one because of delays and whatnot.
Yeah, like many years. Well, and apart from your and I personal delays, like with our lives, like we can't watch things when it comes out sometimes. So
right.
Combined with Hollywood's delays, COVID delays, our personal life delays, this has been a long and 36 years after the first one came out. It's been a long time coming.
Been a long time coming, for sure.
So the description for this one, after 36 years, like we just mentioned, Maverick is still pushing the envelope as a top naval aviator, but must confront ghosts of his past when he leads Top Gun's elite graduates on a mission that demands the ultimate sacrifice from those chosen to fly it. Directed by Joseph Kaczynski, director of Tron Legacy, Oblivion, and my favorite, Taco Bell's Web of Fries. That's a commercial that he did.
Everybody's got to start somewhere.
No, he did that after he did Tron and Oblivion. So I think those two movies didn't do well, even though I really enjoyed them. But his IMDb page was like, you know, TV ads. I think he did a Madonna music video, but then somehow he gets
this guy's all over the place.
He gets this movie. He gets the job.
Like, can you imagine on your resume somebody's like, okay, Madonna video, Top Gun Maverick.
Okay. Highest grossing movie of all time. Like,
okay.
It's insane. And to put this in perspective, Joseph Kaczynski, the director, was 12 years old when he saw Top Gun for the first time.
To be honest with you, though, think about that. Like, a 12-year-old watching Top Gun for the first time. Like, I think you need somebody that age to direct this.
Yeah, because of the hype back then and the feels that you got when you were watching it. And then take that into, you know, it's kind of like with Mortal Kombat. We talked about that last couple weeks, you know.
The nostalgia.
Yeah, I feel like this one, I mean, I'm not comparing this to Mortal Kombat. Please don't get me wrong there, but
okay.
The nostalgia part of it is a component for sure.
Yeah, I mean, from like the first one, obviously, you can't really call it nostalgia because it's the first one, right? But
yeah.
Top Gun is one of those that will never die. Like, that one will live on as a top pick for,
I mean, for eternity. I'll get into this later, but I hope it does. But we'll figure out why I think that a little bit later.
Great.
Top billed stars, of course, Tom Cruise, Jennifer Connelly, Miles Teller, and another one, John Hamm. And not Big sure fan. If this is a spoiler, but Val Kilmer.
Yeah, I don't think that's a spoiler.
I mean, you see his name when you're watching the film. I mean,
yeah,
I won't go into, at least this week, how he comes back. But yeah, Val Kilmer's in it, which is very nice. I'm glad he was.
Very nice.
Considering what he's gone through in the last little while. Have you seen his, have you seen his, like, I don't know, documentary about his life?
Documentary? Mm-mm.
I haven't either, and a lot of people that I've talked to have mentioned it and say it's really good. You get a kind of an
insight. I've heard it's really, really good. Yeah, I've heard it's, like, sad, and a lot is certainly self-inflicted, but... Yeah, like, I'll tell you what, I've been a big Val Kilmer fan.
Oh, dude, I love Val Kilmer, man.
Yeah, I mean, he was fire, right around that first Top Gun. He was just fire with Willow, and Saint is one of my favorite.
Oh, dude, I was about to say Saint, man, like, super underrated. I wish there were more of those. He did such a cool, it was such a fun movie.
Oh, amazing movie.
Runtime for this one, 2 hours and 10 minutes, rated PG-13. Genre on Rotten Tomatoes says action and adventure, although IMDb says action drama. So I've been doing this lately where I go deep dive into their rubric for these genre titles. So I'm going to read to you the description for action and adventure and see if we feel like it fits. So here's action. Should contain numerous scenes where action is spectacular and usually destructive. Often includes nonstop motion, high energy, physical stunts, chases, battles, and destructive crises, floods, explosions, natural disasters, fires, etc. Note, if a movie contains just one action scene, even if prolonged, i.e. airplane accident, it does not qualify as action.
Huh.
Examples are Die Hard from 1988, The Avengers, and Wonder Woman. Those are the examples they give for action.
I would say this one qualifies.
Yeah, 1,000%. Yeah. Here's adventure. And Rotten Tomatoes does not qualify this as a drama, but this is adventure. Should contain numerous consecutive and interrelated scenes of characters participating in hazardous or exciting experiences for a specific goal. Often includes searches or expeditions for lost continents and exotic locales. Characters embarking in treasure hunting or heroic journeys, travels, and quests for the unknown. Not to be confused with action, and should only sometimes be supplied with it. Examples are Goonies, Lord of the Rings, and Life of Pi.
Okay.
I don't know.
I don't think this qualifies for adventure.
Yeah, but it's not drama. I don't think their description of what adventure is. This is adventurous, man. Do you say it's a drama?
But there's, I would say it's drama, yeah.
All right. I mean, there's drama moments, but it's for sure more action and adventure.
There's a lot of heavy moments.
I mean, there's tense moments. There's not a lot of heavy moments.
Like, emotionally heavy?
I mean, I guess we're not spoiling Top Gun from 86. If you haven't seen that, I mean, go get on that right now, but... I mean, there's a lot of stuff about, you know, Goose and his, you know, his boy. But, like, other than that, like, what is heavy? That's the only heavy stuff, I think.
Well, Let It Go, right?
Well, yeah, that obviously.
So there was a lot weighing on Mav. So, no, I would classify it as just pure action. But if you're going to pigeonhole me into saying more and more, I'd probably say drama.
All right.
Definitely not adventure. I don't think adventure.
I think it's adventure and the sprinkling of drama. That's my take.
Okay.
IMDb, speaking of IMDb, the rating is 8.4 out of 10, which is super high for an IMDb rating from 362,000 reviews. Rotten Tomatoes, however, gives it 96% from 445 critic ratings and 99% from 50,000 audience ratings.
What's the highest IMDb you've ever seen? Do you know what the highest
rated? I think it is one of the Lord of the Rings films. And so Lord of the Rings, Return of the King has 9.0 on IMDb rating.
And this is 8.4?
8.4. Let's see. There's another one on there that gets a lot of hype for some reason, which is the Shawshank Redemption. 9.3. Those are, I think, the highest I've ever seen on IMDb. So anything over a 7 is very, very challenging to get based on the amount of ratings. So it's super high.
It's hard to like engage and relate this movie without like completely spoiling exactly how you feel.
Well, I think we could talk about how we like, if we like it. Towards the end, I think that's a good, that's what, I mean, this is the show, should you watch this? So yeah, we won't spoil it, but we're going to talk about what generally speaking, how we like it. But let's get into the rest of the details. So where to watch this right now? At the time of the recording, you can only purchase the digital copy from your preferred purveyor of digital media, or if you choose the highest tier of our Patreon account, you'll have access to the Popcorn Priest's permanent collection. Go to patreon.com/popcornpriest for details. And now we're getting into a new segment that I love to call Popcorn Reviews the Reviews. So here, we did this last time with you for the first time, but this is where I cherry pick some of the worst reviews and some of the best reviews. And we just talk about them. See if we agree.
This is one of my favorites.
Okay, so the first one, we're going with the worst. Start with the bad eggs and get to the good ones. So the first one is not bad, but way overrated, says Horror Flick Fanatic. There really isn't a whole lot of meat and potatoes to this story. It's largely a copy pasta. He says copy pasta. I'm sure he missed... mistyped that. A copy pasta in large chunks from the older film, but with newer, younger faces. 6 out of 10 stars. I mean, number one, Horror Flick Fanatic. Like, do we want your horror review of Maverick, Top Gun Maverick?
Well, we clearly do because we're talking about it on our own movie review. But like, if you're doing a movie about fighter pilots, they're going to do fighter pilot stuff. So I don't know how you can call that a copy pasta.
Yeah, copy pasta, man. Like, I feel like this is, if I like pasta, since we're talking about copy pasta, I want to eat the same pasta again because I enjoyed the first dish of pasta. So,
yes.
Sorry, Horror Flick Fanatic. All right. Siren Synapsis says, brain dead garbage. I couldn't say it better.
What?
Yeah. So I stole the text, shallow romance, shallow character work, extremely predictable. How did Tom Cruise even survive at the start? Literally no stakes. Mission is extremely vague. No one in the film has any understanding of planes. And this is coming from an actual pilot. I hate this movie and everyone who liked it. 1 out of 10 stars.
Come on.
Okay. This brings up a good point. If you're a pilot, I'm not a pilot, but I can't imagine we're going to get into it this week and next week, how much painstaking work they went into film the planes, the flying scenes. The dogfight scenes, okay? Mm-hmm. If you're a pilot, like, can't you appreciate that? I can't. It's just so mind-boggling to hear that review.
First of all, I would love to know what kind of pilot because there's pilot gas stations, which I think fits this person probably best, right?
Maybe he drives a Honda Pilot.
That's all. See, there's many, many pilots that this pilot could possibly be piloting. So, hey, like without the crazies of the world, we wouldn't be normal.
True. Well, brain dead garbage from Siren Synapsis. And the last horrible review is Star Wars meets Finding Nemo, says Mark A. Bracken, 65268. Almost walked out. Massive budget and almost laughable story. It felt like a Star Wars movie in the air versus in space. Terrible acting, terrible story. It makes me mad so many people love this movie. 1 out of 10 stars.
Finding Nemo?
I mean, I get the Star Wars reference because of like the trench fighting and like the pilots have to, you know, blow up the Death Star. Yeah. But like Finding Nemo, like, what does that even mean? Is it because he's finding? Well, I don't get that.
Like there's a part in the movie where they're talking about hitting a small target. And when they were talking about that, I did think of Luke talking about hitting womp rats back home.
Yeah. So, yeah.
I did connect that. No BS. Like I literally like chuckled to myself and that quote came to my mind. But
can I ask you this? When you heard that and you made that connection and you're like made the little chuckle, how many seconds did it take for you to not be thinking about that anymore?
I was already done and I couldn't.
Yeah, you're back in the story.
What was about to unfold?
Yeah, exactly.
Like, let's go.
Yeah. 100%. Yeah,
you guys better accomplish that mission.
Yeah.
No matter how impossible the task. So I was right back into it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
All right, here's three good reviews. These are top cream reviews. So Love Fallout, what is it? Love Fallout Kinda Gamer says, let me just say, ... I was reluctantly dragged into the theater thinking that they didn't need to make a Top Gun 2. And that the first one was where the story needed to end. I could write a couple paragraphs to summarize my feelings after walking out of the theater, but I'm going to leave it with just one sentence. I was wrong. 10 out of 10 stars.
See, now that is action and drama from a review standpoint. But I love the review. Like, hell yes.
Yeah.
I think we all probably thought, man.
I did, dude. Of all people, Love Fallout kind of gamer, I was with you, man. I hated the first movie a lot. And I'll tell you why later. But I was like, this is... I'm only watching this because my wife and my father-in-law want to watch this and I have a nice theater and we're going to blast all my 12 speakers out. And that's why I wanted to see it, but I didn't care at all, but I was wrong. Wait, also.
Wait, you didn't like the first Top Gun?
No.
How have I missed this inference from the beginning of this podcast?
I kind of dropped a hint early on that I wasn't going to agree with you on that. Yeah, no, I'm out on Top Gun 1, and I'm so glad that this one is so much better than the first one, in my opinion.
Okay.
All right, last two positive reviews. Holy cow, such a great IMAX experience from Unique Particle. Tom Cruise is still an ultimate being at 59 years old. It's outstanding. 10 out of 10 stars. And the last one, this is so great. This is funny. I don't know how to pronounce this. Pucciarello says, I paid for the whole seat, but I only used the edge. Number one. Number one, the flying scenes were incredible and had me on the edge of my seat. Number two, Tom Cruise and Miles Teller were awesome. And number three, I want to quit my job and become a fighter pilot now. 10 out of 10 stars.
And like, you know that he probably goes to, because you and I, we grew up somewhere where there was actually an Air Force base. Granted, this is Navy, but
yeah.
I can just picture this guy like halfway through his shift at a gas station, and he's like, at this, I quit. And then he's just jogging up to the gate, and they're like, what are you even doing? Like,
listening to the theme song.
List. Yeah. And he's just like, let's go. And then he goes to the gate, and they're like, this isn't even how you become a enlist in the armed forces. Like, what are you even doing, bro?
This is how he's running up. And he's got like his his kids when he went to fly on Delta for the first time. He's got those little wings and he's like got that on his leather jacket. He's like, where can I sign up?
What do you think? Which movie impacted their particular profession more, The Karate Kid or Top Gun?
Are you talking about like the Navy and the fire pilots versus people like getting into karate?
Right. Like how many people actually went and started karate classes and actually went and enlisted in the Navy or Air Force after seeing their respective movies? Oh, it's got to be Top Gun
by a high margin in the 80s. I bet everyone wanted to be like a fighter pilot.
Yeah. I swear there's studies on that there was a huge increase during that first movie.
A million percent. Yeah, for sure.
Yeah.
I mean,
so maybe I'm with that guy.
I'm not a military guy, and I'm like, if the country needs me, I'll go. Of course. Yeah. All right. This brings us. What? Oh yeah,
Pucciarello.
I got you. I got your back. This brings us to our hottest segment in podcasting right now. Should or shouldn't you watch this? Five reasons. Oh, extra air horn there. Five reasons why you should watch this, and you please add your reasons if I miss something. Here are my five. Number one, if you watched the first Top Gun and liked it, this is for you. Mm-hmm. Number two, if you watched the first Top Gun and hated it, which is me, this is for you. And the reason why I say that is if you didn't like the first Top Gun, please take a chance on this one. That's what I'm saying.
I still don't understand how anybody could watch the first Top Gun and not like it. So
it's terrible. Number three, I think
you're speaking to three other people when you.
I'm talking to
you and three other
horror flick fanatic. Siren Synapsis and Mark A. Bracken, 65268. Yeah, me and right. Those guys did. But I'm different than them because I like the second one. So,
right.
Number three, if you don't want to watch a blockbuster popcorn film and turn your brain off and have some GD fun, then this is not for you. Okay. And number four, if you want to see some of the most incredible, and I say this not lightly, some incredible IMAX scenes in recent memory, this is for you. Also, a tack onto that, the Dolby Atmos mix is top notch.
Really?
Yeah. And what I'm talking about, Atmos, for those of you who don't know what that is, it's basically they're running some movies. It's not built into the film. They just, shove extra sound to the speakers that are in the ceiling, but most movies who have a Dolby Atmos track, they mix it for the ceiling of your theater. And so if you have Atmos speakers, you're gonna feel like these planes are flying all around you, and it's the best thing of all time.
Yeah, dude. I just for me, still just that nostalgia. We talked about it a lot with Mortal Kombat when we reviewed that, and this had similar vibes.
Yeah. Here's, and that could be another reason, the nostalgia for sure. And that's why I said, if you like the first Top Gun, you got to watch this for sure.
I'll say two other things.
Okay. I still have one more reason, but Tom Cruise, I want to hear your other.
Okay, good.
You go.
You finish.
No, I want to have the last word. No, you go.
You finish.
All right. Number five, last reason. Although some of the reviews say otherwise, the first scene with Tom flying really changed my mind coming into this with my angry expectations. After I saw this first sequence, I'm like, Tom, let the planes wash over me. I'm with you till the end.
Amen.
All right. What are your two addendums to the should you watch this list?
Yeah, I would say Tom Cruise.
Yeah.
So if you're a Tom Cruise fan, which I don't know how you cannot possibly be one.
I mean, yeah, I don't know why I didn't put that as a reason, but you're right. Tom Cruise alone is the reason to watch this.
Now, I'm going to make sure that my father listens to this podcast.
Okay, good.
This has been...
What's up, Pops?
This has been an ongoing debate that has really brought a divide into the family.
Oh,
and
okay,
almost brought us to physical altercations over nice ribs at a very nice restaurant in Phoenix, Arizona.
Ooh.
He'll know what I'm talking about.
It was
quite the argument about Tom Cruise.
Don't spoil them ribs, man.
What else would a family fight over other than Tom Cruise? And my argument is,
What's the argument?
Can you possibly dislike Tom Cruise? He dislikes Tom Cruise. He doesn't like his movie.
Pops doesn't like Tom Cruise?
No. And I'm like, name one bad Tom Cruise movie besides Vanilla Sky. Try.
I mean, dude.
Is there anybody that could top Tom Cruise as far as the volume of amazing movies?
I mean, maybe Samuel Jackson, because he's been in so many different crazy high box office franchises, but nothing like Tom Cruise and his commitment to filmmaking.
Yeah.
And here's the thing, maybe people out there cannot separate Tom Cruise from the actor and Tom Cruise, the person. Cause yeah, I don't, maybe there's some stuff that I don't like that he's talking about, but I don't care. That's not what I'm going to the movie for. I'm not going to hear his views on, you know, what's the religion he belongs?
Scientology.
Yeah, Scientology. I don't care.
Hey, you're a man of faith that often gets very much confused, right? So, like, for me, though, I'm with you. Like, I don't know the man personally.
I don't care.
I'm never going to know the man personally. I just want him to entertain me, and he does every single time.
Yes.
I think he's I go back and forth with him and Leonardo DiCaprio on who's the greatest of all time. And I would actually leave it in one of their hands.
I mean, I would lean towards Tom Cruise, but that's the same reason why I love Stallone and Arnold. Like, please shoot as much HGH and steroids into your body as possible.
Yes.
Please. Whatever you can give me for as long as you can give it to me. That's what I want.
That's what I want.
Yeah.
That's what I spend my hard earned money for. And it's the same when it comes to sports. If these guys want to shoot it up to run faster, jump higher, and entertain me even more, it's their choice. Let them do it.
Correct.
So I'm with you.
All right. Any other reasons that we missed before we get into by the numbers?
No, I think that's a good list.
All right. Love it.
Blank. For God's sake, just give me the damn number.
All right. I got some conflicting numbers. But what's the budget for this film? What do you think? And I know you didn't do any research because you don't do any anymore.
I did not.
Which is great.
I have no idea on this, but I would put it at 190.
That's awesome, dude. So I got two numbers. I got between 152 and $170 million.
Okay.
Which...
So I was way high, but...
No, you said 180. It was a lot. It's like $10 million over. Like, what's $10 million with $170 million budget?
Yeah.
And who knows if that includes like marketing and everything else, but like, listen, this doesn't happen very often. You know, movies nowadays with $100 to $200 million budgets, it's far and wide between, but I believe because of this movie, there will be more. And I'm glad that this happened and when it happened.
Yeah. Like this was an homage and a throwback to when movies were great.
Yeah. So guess what this made? And it's probably like, as I'm talking right now, the numbers are still going up even after it's left the theaters. Actually, it's probably still in some theaters somewhere, but like major theaters don't have this anymore.
Yeah, I would probably say 1.1 billion.
Okay, so here's the domestic haul. 707 million, just domestic. And then worldwide is $1.44 billion. So I'm just going to rapid fire all the records that it broke. Okay. Highest grossing film of 2022. Easy. Highest grossing film of Tom's career. Number one best-selling digital sell-through title ever in the United States in the first week of release. Top 20 best-selling digital releases in history. And has been the top-selling item on Amazon in the U.S. since it was released. The sixth highest-grossing film in domestic box office history of all time. Number one ranked as the widest opening by studio type of all time. Widest opening by the MPA rating, which is PG-13, of all time. Holiday opening weekend broke ranks number one on Memorial Day. Also, holiday weekend, so the opening day and the weekend total ranks number one. The widest release, so it's in the most theaters for a PG-13 rating, and also widest opening for a major studio, ranks number one. And this is the fifth film that has earned $1 billion worldwide without being released in China. The first four films to do that are Pirates of the Caribbean, Dead Man's Chest, Dark Knight, The Joker from 2019, and Spider-Man No Way Home, without having China's money, yen.
I love that.
It's unbelievable.
It deserves it all.
Yeah.
Deserves it
all. Give them all the money. Give them more. Like, and I heard that Tom Cruise took a back-end deal, and he'll probably clear between over $50 million for his paycheck.
Good for him.
Yeah. 1,000%.
Worth every penny. Worth every single cent. And we'll express more on the back end, but
yeah,
good for them.
All right, here's some by the numbers. No spoilery numbers, but by the numbers. The World War II P-51 Mustang scene in this movie is actually Tom Cruise's own airplane. Cruise is an accomplished pilot in real life, of course. Tom Cruise personally designed a 3-month aviation training course for the new actors to become ready to handle riding in an F-18. So he was basically a Top Gun instructor in real life.
That's unbelievable. And I would love to see some of the actual footage of these guys.
Yeah, give me like a 3-part documentary of the filming and the training program.
Don't you think that would do hundreds of millions?
It would be fun to watch.
I would watch it right now.
Yeah. Okay. I'm going to wait to bring this up, but then the astronomical amount of footage that they have filmed is insane. Mm-hmm. But I want that to punctuate the end of our episode this week. So this film is dedicated to the memory of original Top Gun director Tony Scott, who died by suicide on August 19th, 2012, at the age of 68. He had been developing his own version of the sequel before his death. R.I.P. Tony Scott. I love Tony Scott, and this is probably the only movie that I'm not a big fan of his, but I love a lot of his movies, man.
Very accomplished. Yeah, very accomplished.
Tom Cruise is now older than Tom Skerritt when he played Viper in the original Top Gun in 1986. Skerritt was 58 in 1986, and Cruise was 56 in 2018 when the movie was filmed, and 59 in 2022 when it premiered. He's just turned 60.
Tom Cruise, I swear, never ages.
No, he's got, I don't know, gypsy tears or some kind of ointments. Maybe
you can see most Hollywood elites as they age, where they've had a lot of work done and the naturalness of them fades away. There's something about Tom Cruise that it doesn't look like, and clearly he's had work done, but it doesn't look
you that think way. You think he's had work done on his face?
Bro, he's almost 60 and he looks like he's 30 years old.
I mean, I didn't do any extensive plastic surgery research on Tom Cruise's face, but I now want to.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I'm interested, but he never ages. He's just amazing.
Yeah. He's probably found like an extinct like species of animal where they're extracting bone marrow out of it. And it allows him not to age. Something like that, right? For sure. Or maybe he's like sucking souls like out of humans. They like bring him in and he just takes their essence.
Maybe Scientology's not so bad after all.
I mean, maybe we should look into it. Maybe we should look into it.
Yeah.
But I also don't have, you know, hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of millions of dollars in my bank account. So that might be another reason.
Yeah. Yeah, if not billions, right?
Yeah, All right, another number, a couple more. The Navy's oldest fighter pilot retired at age 54. Calculating from Maverick's birth in 1962 and counting to 2022 when the film actually came out, he is 60 in this film, pushing the envelope, as pilots say. The sequel represents one of the longest periods of time between a movie and a sequel in film history. The period of time between Top Gun and Top Gun Maverick being first released about 36 years ago, though it could have been less had it not been for delays caused by COVID. Other examples of extremely long intervals of original films and sequels are, can you name some of them? I have all of them because I did the research, but.
Yeah, I was just barely trying to think of one very, very quickly. And I know there's some coming out, like Coming to America.
Oh, yeah.
With Eddie Murphy, but
that one is already out.
Is it out?
Yeah, it's on Amazon.
That's how.
Yeah.
Okay. Did you watch it?
I didn't. I wanted to as well, but I just didn't.
Well, I love the first one, but no, I don't. I can't think of any that would span 26 years.
All right. So
is it 26 or 36?
36.
Yeah. Not for a sequel. No way.
So Tron, 1982, and Tron Legacy, yeah, who was directed by the director of Top Gun Maverick, that was 28 years. The Odd Couple and The Odd Couple 2 is 30 years, 1968 and 1998. Blade Runner from 1982 and Blade Runner 2049, which I love, is 2017, which is 35 years, so almost beat it.
Yep.
And then the gap between The Wizard of Oz from 1939 and Return to Oz from 1985 is 46 years. But the record, you'll never get this, and I wouldn't have either, but the record, it holds a 62-year gap. What do you think it is? 62 years between sequel.
Charlie Chaplin?
Anything would have been amazing if you would have guessed slightly close, but Bambi from 1942 and Bambi 2 from 2006 is 62 years.
I didn't even know there was a Bambi 2.
Me neither. We'd never would have guessed it, but anyway, there you have it.
Do you think this works any other time?
It's so weird how perfect it happened, because the studios wanted to release this on Paramount Plus only, and Cruise was like, no. And thank the Lord that he had as much clout as he did, because he's like, no, this has to be seen in theaters, and I want to release it in theaters. So they waited a year, then they had to delay it again for another year, and then another like half a year. And it came out in the summer of the time, the best possible time, when people just wanted something.
Needed it.
Yeah. And that's...
I wish I would have seen it in the theater.
I saw it in the theater, and I also saw it in my theater, and both times were amazing. I mean, humble brag, I've got a 133-inch screen with like way too much money spent on speakers, so it sounded real great, and it was on 4K Dolby Atmos, just super awesome.
Did people clap in the theater?
Yeah. People were cheering, bro. I didn't go see it when it like came out. First. It was way later when I could sneak away and go see it. But yeah, unbelievable. Yeah. So here's how I want to punctuate the end of this episode. And then I kind of want to just a brief, like what was your impression of it? I mean, everyone can kind of tell already that what we think, but here's my last punctuation. And this is a quote from the director. Out of a 12 or 14 hour day, you might get 30 seconds of good footage, Kaczynski said about why so much footage was shot. But it was so hard earned. It just took a very long time to get it all. Months and months of aerial shooting. We shot as much footage as the three Lord of the Rings movies combined. I think it must have been 800 hours of footage to get a 2 hour and 10 minute film.
Unreal.
I mean, I really like this movie a lot. So I'm not going to give my rating until next week, but love it.
Think about what that means though. Like that means that this was a career maker for, not the actors, right? Because most of the actors were already have very successful careers. But when you're talking about 800 hours of footage, the team that had to painstakingly go through that made a career for themselves from this movie. Like they are tops in the industry at what they do.
I mean, yeah, 1,000%.
So it's impressive to me. It's truly impressive to me.
Yeah. Anything else you want to talk about before we take a short break till next week?
Yeah, no, because I'm going to save it all for next
week. All right. At this point, there may be some spoilers up ahead next week. So if you want to watch and then come back next week and join us for a breakdown of Top Gun, Mega Money Machine Maverick from 2022. I'm on the social medias, and I dare you to message the great Popcorn Priest at Popcorn Priest. I love movies and would love it if you'd share the love. Share this with the movie lover in your life. Another way to support the show is by throwing a few shekels at the priest by visiting patreon.com/popcornpriest and see what extra perks you can enjoy. Lastly, and the easiest way to support the show, and the most free, is like, subscribe, and give us a 5-star review. Easier than starting your car or starting your F-18 fighter pilot plane. As always, thanks for listening, and thanks to my special guest, Dan Sakulich. Always a pleasure to have you on the show.
Absolutely, buddy. Until next week.
Yeah, join us next week for part 2 of Maverick. We'll see you next week.